rich place, if I may say so. And it has given us a lot of things to enjoy. For people with sweet tooth, some nice rasagullas. Non-vegetarians, some nice fish fry. Some hot Bengali babes. And for somebody like me, who likes the art and culture, he gave us Rabindranath Tagore. A great poet, a great writer. Somebody who was very advanced for his age, for his era that Calcutta was going through at that time. This story is called as the Kabuliwala. A little introduction on what the story is about is, during this story set at a time where the trade was just beginning in India, and Calcutta, as that it was called at that time, was at the epicenter of the trade, and that is when people from foreign lands started coming to India with a lot of things. People from Afghanistan, Pakistan, Istanbul, and all those areas were traveling to India. There was a cultural influx that started. Women were a little perturbed about as to how these people are coming in. So this story is about, as I would say, it's a story of trust. A story of how we presume or assume people are and how they actually turn out to be. The story is called The Kabuliwala from Rabindranath Tagore. My 5-year-old daughter, Minnie, cannot live without chattering. I really believe that in all her life, she has not wasted a minute in silence. Her mother is often vexed at this and would stop her at her prattle, but I would not. One morning, for instance, when I was in the midst of the 17th chapter of my new novel, my little Minnie stole into the room and, putting her hand into mine, said, "Father, Ram there, the doorkeeper, calls a crow a craw. He doesn't know anything, does he?" Before I could explain further, she went on to another question. "What do you think, Father? Bola says there's an elephant in the cloud, blowing water out of his trunk, and that is why it rains." And then darting off anew, while I sat still making ready some reply to her answers, "Father, what relation is mother to you?" With a grave face, I contrived and I said, "Go play with Bola, Minnie. I am busy." The window of my room overlooks the road. The child had seated herself at my feet near my table and was playing softly, drumming on her knees. I was hard at work on my 17th chapter, where the hero Pratap Singh had just caught Kanchan Lada, the heroine, in his arms and was about to escape with her by the third story window of the castle, when all of a sudden Minnie left her plane and ran to the window and said, "A Kabuliwala, a Kabuliwala." Sure enough, in the street there was a Kabuliwala passing slowly along. He wore loose, soiled clothing of his people, the tall turban, and there was a bag on his back that carried a box of grapes. I cannot tell what were my daughter's feelings at the sight of this man, but she began to call him out loudly. "Ah," I thought, "he will come in and my 17th chapter will never be finished." At which exact moment the Kabuliwala turned and looked up at the child. When she saw this, overcome by terror, she fled to her mother's protection and disappeared. She had a blind belief that inside the bag which the man carried, there were perhaps 2 or 3 other children like herself. The peddler, meanwhile, entered my doorway and greeted me with a smiling face. So precarious was the position of my heroine in my chapter, that my first impulse was to stop and buy something till the man had been caught. I made some small purchases and a conversation began about Abdurrahman, the Russians, the Englishmen, and the frontier policy. As he was about to leave, he asked, "Where is the little girl, sir?" And I, thinking that Minnie must get rid of her fall of fear, had her brought out. She stood by the chair and looked at the Kabuliwala and his bag. He offered her nuts and raisins, but she would not be tempted and only clung to me closer, with all her doubts increased. This was their very first meeting. One morning, however, not many days later, as I was leaving the house, I was startled to find Minnie seated on a bench near the door, laughing and talking with the great Kabuliwala at her feet. In all her life, it appeared, my small daughter had never found so patient a listener. Thank God for me. And already the corner of her little sari was stuffed with almonds and raisins, the gift of a visitor. Why did you give her those? I asked. And taking out an 8 anna, I handed it out to him. The man accepted the money without demur and slipped it into his pocket. Alarmed on my return an hour later, I found the unfortunate coin had made twice its own worth of trouble. For the Kabuliwala had given it to Minnie, and her mother, catching sight of the bright round object, had pounced on the child with it. Where did you get that 8 anna bit? Minnie cheerfully said, the Kabuliwala gave it to me. The Kabuliwala gave it to you? Cried her mother. Oh, Minnie, how can you take it from him? I, entering at that moment, saved her from the impending disaster. It was the first or the second time I found that the two had met. The Kabuliwala had overcome the child's first terror by judicious bribery of nuts and almonds, and the two were great friends now. They had many quaint jokes which afforded them amusement. Minnie would ripple her face with laughter and begin, Oh Kabuliwala, Kabuliwala, what have you got in your bag today? And he would reply in a nasal accent of a mountaineer, An elephant. Not much cause for merriment perhaps, but how they both enjoyed the fun. Then the Kabuliwala, not to be behind-handed, would take his turn. Well, little one, when are you going to your father-in-law's house? Now most small Bengali maidens have heard long ago about father-in-law's house. But we being little newfangled had kept these things from our child. And Minnie at this question must have been triple bibbled. But she was not to showing it. And with ready tact replied, Are you going there, Kabuliwala? Amongst the men of Kabuliwala's class, however, it is well known that the word father-in-law's house has a double meaning. It is a euphemism for jail, the place where we all are cared for and at no expense for ourselves. In this sense, the peddler takes my daughter's question. Ah, he would say, shaking his fist at an invisible policeman, I will thrash my father-in-law. Hearing this and picturing the poor discomfited relative, Minnie would go off into a peal of laughter in which her formidable friend would join. These were autumn mornings, the very time of the year when kings of old went forth to conquest, and I, never stirring from my little corner in Calcutta, would let my mind wander over the whole world. I would fall to weaving a network of dreams, the mountains, the glens, and the forests of his distant home, with his cottage in its setting and the free and independent life of faraway wilds of Kabuliwala's land. Perhaps the scenes of travel conjure themselves upon me and pass and repass in my imagination. In the presence of this Kabuliwala, I was immediately transported to the foot of arid mountain peaks, with narrow little defiles twisting in and out amongst their towering heights. I could see the strings of camels bearing the merchandise and the company of turbaned merchants carrying some of their cured old firearms. I could see. But at such point, Minnie's mother would intervene, imploring me to beware of that man. Minnie's mother is unfortunately a very timid lady. Whenever she hears a noise in the street or sees people coming towards the house, she always jumps to the conclusion that they are either thieves, drunkards, snakes, cockroaches, caterpillars, tigers, or just malaria. Even after all these years of experience, she is not able to overcome her terror. I tried to laugh her fear gently away, but then she would turn around to me seriously and ask me solemn questions. Were children never kidnapped? Was it then not true that there was Kabul? I urged that, though not impossible, it was highly improbable. But this was not enough, and her dread persisted. Once a year, in the middle of January, Rahman the Kabuliwala was in the habit of returning to this country. And as the time approached, he would be very busy going from house to house collecting debts. But he would find time to meet Mini. Even to me, it was a little startling now and then in the corner of the dark room, suddenly to surprise this tall, loose-garment man. But when Mini would run, smiling to him with, "Oh, Kabuliwala, Kabuliwala," and the two friends, so far apart in age, would subside into their old laughter and their old jokes. One morning, a few days before he had made up his mind to go, I was correcting my proof sheet in my study. It was a chilly weather. Through the windows, the rays of the sun touched my feet, and the slight warmth was very welcome. It was almost 8 o'clock, and the early pedestrians were returning. Returning home with their heads covered. All at once, I heard an uproar in the street, and looking out, saw Rahman being led away, bound between two policemen, and behind them a crowd of furious boys. There were bloodstains on the clothes of Kabuliwala, and on one of the policemen carried a knife. Hurrying out, I stopped them and inquired what it all meant. Partly from one, partly from another, I gathered that a certain neighbor had owed the peddler something for a Rampuri shawl, but had falsely denied having bought it. And in the course of quarrel, Rahman had struck him. Now in the heat of this excitement, the prisoner began calling his enemy all sorts of names. Then suddenly in the veranda of my house, appeared my little Mini, with the usual exclamation, "Oh, Kabuliwala, Kabuliwala!" Rahman's face lit up as he turned to her. He had no bag under his arm today. She at once therefore proceeded to the next question, "Are you going to your father-in-law's house?" Rahman laughed and said, "Just where I'm going, my little one." Thank you.